This is Andy Porowal for Boxing News. I'm joined by promoter Eddie Hearn here in Belfast. Eddie, joined us today. The PJ on hold?
No. BA though, we've moved up from Ryanair. Last week in Dublin we were Ryanair. This week we're BA. But I'm back and forward. Obviously got another huge show in Belfast this Saturday after just a historic night in Dublin, and back for some filming for Day of Reckoning tomorrow. And then back out on Saturday. So, yeah. And then off to San Francisco. And then Phoenix. And then Saudi Arabia. And then we'll have about a week or 10 days off. But yeah, looking forward to a great run after a tremendous night last week in Dublin.
Great run. You'll be seeing me at a lot of those events, Eddie. Yourself and Frank going to film some content together?
I don't know about that. But no, excited for Day of Reckoning. I mean, you know, obviously the plans that Saudi and His Excellency have, not just around the fight card, but the way they do things from a production content point of view. We're all up for helping and want to make the night as special as possible. I think December 23 will be huge.
Let's swing back to this card. Michael Conlan, Jordan Gill headlining. A lot of expectation that Michael Conlan's going to look, but not just impressive, but do a bit of a one-sided job on Jordan Gill. Do you think people are sleeping on Jordan?
Yes, but he needs to do a one-sided job if people are going to get excited to the levels that we need them to be for the fights that we could make. So for Jordan, you know, we're very fond of, going to put everything into this fight. It's really a shot to nothing for him. If Jordan Gill wins, my God, I mean, he all of a sudden lands himself a massive fight in the super featherweight division. But for Michael Conlan, an impressive win will open up fights with Lee Wood, with Josh Warrington, with Joe Caldina. And as you'll see on Saturday, he's a big draw. So he can fight here, he can bring travelling fans to Nottingham or to Cardiff. You've seen travelling fans or people in New York to come out and watch him. But he really needs to grab the attention of the people and get the belief back in people that he's got plenty more to give to the sport. And I think the move to 130 for both guys will really suit them.
Would you expect to see him at main event?
It all depends on how they're holding a shot. Don't forget, Michael Conlan's been knocked out twice, heavily. And Jordan Gill got hurt badly against Kiko Martinez. But they were both at 126. So I don't know how much has got to do with the weight or how durable both guys are at this stage in their career. If Jordan Gill can take a shot up at 130, I think he has a great chance in this fight. But if he gets hurt, then the fight will be over inside 6 rounds. And Michael Conlan, sometimes a fighter's punch resistance will just desert them after a couple of bad knockouts. So I think it's more about actually what these guys have left. On paper, you say Michael Conlan should dominate this fight. But if he's not the fighter that he once was, and Jordan up at 130 is stronger and more robust, I think he has a shot.
I know Mick very much so wants that Lee Wood rematch. From what's been said so far, seems to be more of an interest in Wood Warrington too. What does Mick have to do to try and edge ahead of Josh in trying to make a rematch for it?
I mean, look, you've got the benefit of travelling fans from both sides. I mean, the Conlan-Wood fight was probably the best fight I've ever seen. One of the most dramatic finishes, well, the most dramatic finish I've ever seen. And the Wood-Warrington fight was another thriller that was very controversial in its ending, whatever way you want to look at it. So I think Lee Wood would entertain both those fights. They're both fights that would sell City Ground perfectly. Both have huge travelling fans as well. But, you know, the focus has definitely been on the Josh Warrington rematch, but a big statement from Mick Conlan could change that on Saturday.
Eddie, just your thoughts on the rest of the card as well. Some great fights, great matchup.
Really good card. I mean, you know, four brilliant TV fights. Called Sean McComb against Sam Maxwell, tremendous fight. I love Kevin Ajarko against Troy Williamson because it's exactly the kind of fight where you get to find out what you've got in Kevin Ajarko. If he's what we hope he is and think he is, he'll look sensational. If he's not, he'll get beat. And that's the kind of test you want. Tyrone McKenna against Lewis Crocker. I mean, wait till you hear the atmosphere. It's going to be wild. It's going to be brutal. Just a really good night. And obviously Cameron Vong as well in a third run out in, I think, 9 weeks. Layli Bustle gig as well. Tremendous young talent. Plenty more. And yeah, really, really good night of boxing.
Eddie, I know it won't be the first and I won't be the last to ask you about the comments from Robert Smith recently saying that he won't and he hasn't approved Conor's application to fight in the beginning of next year against Chris Eubank Jr. What did you make of what Robert had to say in his application being rejected?
It was very nice of him to explain that on TalkSport live rather than to explain it to us. But it's what we've become used to now. I think a lot of Robert's comments tomorrow will be rectified shortly by Conor Benn's, well, by the board, because there'll be legal action against them because the comments were completely inaccurate. I don't want to say too much, and I'll answer your questions, because I'm just trying to make the fight. And until we've got a fight, it's all irrelevant anyway. And at the moment, we don't have a fight. Once we are in a position to sign that fight, then we have to decide what we're going to do. But we're going to make the fight. So Conor Benn is going to fight Chris Eubank, I believe. If he doesn't, then we don't have an issue. But that's all we're focused on at the moment.
How close was the fight away from the application to the board?
No, I mean, it's been close for 3 weeks now. And, you know, that's the reason that the board were contacted, because the fight was close. It doesn't change our desire to make the fight or change the conversations. And everybody knows, you know, prior to that application, that we were moving forward with the fight regardless. So, again, at the moment, it's irrelevant. But hopefully, in the next 2 or 3 days, the fight will be signed.
You've obviously said previously you want that fight to take place in the UK and you didn't want to explore any other commissions, you didn't want it to go for any other board, you wanted it to be under the British Boxing Board of Control. Have things changed now? Are you starting to consider other options?
No, the fight will take place in Britain.
Under the British Boxing Board of Control?
They decide to sanction it, you know, and obviously we'll have our own legal position on that. Again, until the fight is signed, we won't put a clear strategy together for that. You know, there's multiple promoters, and there's always decisions to make. For us, we will always try and work with the British Boxing Board of Control until there is an agenda or until fighters or organisations are treated unfairly. If that is the case, we'll consider our position. Hopefully that won't be the case. But I just want to really understand. This is the frustrating thing where you have to listen to things in an interview rather than from the board to us. Why Conor Benn is being treated so differently to other fighters in the past. I mean, there's very high profile fighters, and I don't want to mention their name because then people think that I'm having a dig. World champions who have been treated completely different. So what is it about Conor Benn that makes the board treat him differently to others? That's one for them to answer. The comments from Robert Smith yesterday, which were he hasn't gone down the appropriate channels, is something that they will rectify very soon, because that is the biggest load of rubbish I've ever heard. He was called before the WBC. He was cleared of any wrongdoing by the WBC. He was reinstated into the rankings. He then decided, really, without having to go through the hearing with UKED. He won that hearing. He was cleared. His suspension was lifted. Now, understand, they want to appeal. He won that case in July. He boxed in September. We're now coming up to December. So, you know, we feel that Conor Benn is cleared to box. But until we make the fight, there's no point going too deep into it, but just know that that fight is being attempted to be made.
Can I ask Vinedi, and I imagine I know what type of answer you'd give to this, but should Eubank Benn proceed without the board licensing the fight, what do you expect the board's response to be to that? Is there any risk of any extra sanctions being placed to licence holders?
Yeah, I mean, again, don't know what licence holders will be involved, don't know if they'll be involved, won't be involved. Again, till we make the fight, it's kind of irrelevant. As I said earlier, we will always try and work with the British Boxing Board of Control until there is a moment where we feel that things are unfair. Now, if that's the case, we'll have a decision to make. There are a lot of people involved with the show who have different positions, different licensing positions. Again, I can't stop Conor Benn from taking this fight. And he wants this fight, and so does Chris Eubank Jr. And British boxing needs this fight. It's the biggest fight in British boxing that can be made. It's one of the biggest fights in the history of our sport. It's nearly, or it won't be long till it's 2 years since Conor Benn has boxed in this country. He's been through two different avenues of hearings. He's won them both, and we believe it's time for him to fight in this country, and that's what we'll be trying to do.
February 3rd, still the target date?
It's at Spurs, yeah.
Just away from it, Taylor Cameron too last weekend. Just walk me through Katie getting a revenge.
Yeah, it was an amazing fight. I mean, both girls were incredible. You know, it was a grueling fight. I thought it was one of the performances of Katie Taylor's career, and it needed to be. I felt like she won the fight, another close fight, probably similar kind of fight in terms of distance of victories to the first fight that Chantel won. And now we've got obviously a decision to make about the belts, and then hopefully we can look to make a trilogy. If not...
Trilogy take precedence over Serrano rematch?
Probably, because obviously we work with Chantel, and you know, I just feel like obviously at the moment it's quite raw, and sometimes they'll say, oh, you know, we're up against it going to Dublin. I understand that. You've also made an absolute fortune, life-changing amount of money, and you can do that again. if you want. You know, you were up against it the first fight, you won, and you won fair and square, and you didn't win on Saturday, but weren't a million miles off. And you are going to be up against it fighting Katie Taylor in Ireland. Like, you know, and it, not in terms of a rules position, but just in terms of atmosphere, occasion, like being the away fighter, if you like, even though you're the A side. But that comes with a lot of money. So we're delighted to have given Chantel that opportunity and changed her life in that respect, and she deserves it. But she may feel like, I don't want to go back to Dublin and I'll fight in England. Obviously, financially, that will be completely different. But that's maybe what she wants. And if that's the case, maybe we look at Serrano. It's only really those two fights for Croke Park, and both would be thrillers.
Drew and Eddie, David Benavidez defeated a man you used to promote, Demetrius Andrade. A stunning performance. What did you make of it?
I said he'd stop him. You know, I think Demetrius is just, he's been around too long. You know, his best times have done. Tremendous fighter. You know, you see him win rounds, and but up at 168 against a big, big 168 pounder, I always felt that he'd just get overrun. And that's what he did. It was a great win from Benavidez. And now you can't really question the credentials of Benavidez. You know, he's beaten Andrade. He's beaten Plant. He should get the Canelo Alvarez fight. And it's a massive fight.
Just a final one from me. Devin Haney and Regis Prograin next week. Some huge numbers on social media. Just your thoughts on that. But what are you looking for?
That fight's going to do massive numbers on pay-per-view. You know, much bigger than people expected. I mean, you know, we're going to have 14, 15,000 in San Francisco, which is amazing. You've seen our little old Matchroom YouTube channel drilling, what, 500, 600,000 views on the face-off. Great build-up. Next week's going to be wild. And just looking forward to a massive night in Belfast. San Fran next week. San Francisco. I'm not, apparently they don't like San Fran. So San Francisco. For Haney against Prograin. And then, look, Sonny tries to unify against Bam in Phoenix, which is going to be amazing. And then we're all off to Saudi for nearly for Christmas. So just living a dream. You know, I said earlier at the press conference, imagine a world where it was just huge fight night, huge fight night, huge fight night all around the world. And welcome to the world of Matchroom and Design.
Eddie, thank you for speaking to me.
And boxing news. Okay.
Cheers, guys.